I'm Catherine Byers-White, your host of the Los Altos History Show. Our guest this evening is Wendell Roscoe. Wendell is affectionately known as the mayor of Pink Horse Ranch. We'll be talking with Wendell tonight to find out just how he achieved that title. Welcome, Wendell. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
Before we get started, though, I wanted to draw your attention to our new set. The set designer is Jan Meyer. Perhaps you've noticed her many murals around Los Altos, including two decorating the Colonel's Place, KFC, one on Costume Bank, and the latest on the exterior wall of the Diamond Broker. We're very proud of our new set and thank Jan for interpreting the hillsides of Los Altos so beautifully. Jan, please take a bow. If you've lived in Los Altos or Los Altos Hills, no doubt you recognize the name Wendell Roscoe. Wendell has been designing homes for almost 50 years, designing homes in such places as Beverly Hills, Oahu, Mendocino, Niagara Falls, and Carmel. In the Mid-Peninsula area, there are more than 200 Roscoe design homes, with the majority of them concentrated in this area, Los Altos and Los Altos Hills. If you read the real estate ads, you will often notice the tag name, Roscoe Built. We're going to find out tonight about his love for design, but before we do, we want to find out about Wendell. Wendell, I understand you grew up in Montana on a farm, and that you later moved to Portland. You learned to fly when you were 18. And you started driving a car when you were 10.
Right.
That's amazing. Could you share a little bit about your background?
Learning to drive a car at 10 was to deliver milk in a small town in western North Dakota. And that's a long time before licenses were required or they even know about licenses in that part of the country anyway.
So being raised on a farm in Montana, what were some of the things that you did as you were growing up help besides driving the truck, just help on the farm, helping your father?
Well, I was very small when I lived on the ranch, but later my father became a haystacker for the Ringling Brothers Circus people.
Oh.
And we lived in a tent for several months, and then we went from there to, he was selling religious books from town to town. And of course, I needed a job too, so I sold handheld dust mops. And many times I came home with more money than he did. He'd go to one side of the street and I'd go to the other. So that's the start of my sales training at about 6 and 7 years of age.
And probably your adventuresome spirit, I would assume,
too. I would assume that it came from that.
Well, tell me about, well, I understand you were in Portland, Oregon during the Depression and that you worked in a department store.
Yes.
And then you went from that to start flying airplanes. How did all that come about?
Well, I was fortunate in that I was going to a junior college, and it was Oregon Institute of Technology who had a aviation program but it was all mechanical. In other words, we taught people how to work on airplanes, much the same as they do at San Jose State now. And I ran into another young guy that was 2 or 3 years older than I was, and he invited me to go flying with him. And I became interested and started taking lessons, and I could earn enough in a 2 week time to get about a 15 minute flight. And then we discovered an old airplane in the barn up in Eastern Oregon, and we purchased the airplane for $105.
Which was a lot of money back then.
Which was a lot of money.
Yeah.
So we took it to school and tore it down and rebuilt it. And it had a World War brand new engine from World War I. It was all in Cosmoline and all, and we cleaned that thing all up and put it in the airplane. And then we started teaching one another how to fly.
So you didn't know much about it, and you just went out there and
we just,
that's amazing.
He was an old timer. He had about 18 hours when I had about four. And then we decided to take another fellow in with us because we needed money. And so we taught him to fly. And then one Sunday morning we decided it was time for this guy to solo. And so we got up real early and we were at Pearson Field in Vancouver, which is across the Columbia River from Portland. And we soloed this guy, and he did a real nice job on the first landing. We said, well, go for it, you know, go for another one. Well, the second time around, he leveled off about 75 feet in the air and decided to let gravity take over, which it did. And he crashed our airplane.
Came down
on one wing and just crumpled it all up. So then and he didn't get hurt at all because it was such a slow process. And so then we had to figure out how to get that airplane off the field real quick before somebody saw it. So we found an open hangar and we took our cars and towed that thing into the hangar and slammed the doors real quick before the field manager came. And it just happened that a civil aeronautics inspector came along with him that day, but they didn't see what we did.
Narrow escape.
And that night my dad discovered for the first time that I was flying, because we hauled the airplane over to Portland and put it in my dad's barn. So after that, very shortly after that, the government started a program called the Civilian Pilot Training Program. Mm-hmm. And there was 100 guys in the United States chosen for this program, 10 in each school. And our school was chosen for that. And my dad became very happy over this. I was going to finally get some good training and fly in little better airplanes. And we started out in a J-3 Cub, and which was the primary trainer at that time. And we went through then 200 hours of training in various types of airplanes, aerobatic, instructors rating, cross-country, and instrument, and we ended up with a commercial license and instructors rating. And then we were ready. By that time, the war was imminent, and they needed instructors in the Air Force, and I went to work for the Royal Air Force as an instructor in the Mojave Desert, a place called Origo Field at Lancaster.
Well, I understand you flew clipper ships for Pan American.
Yes.
So you went from flying antique planes to flying state-of-the-art equipment.
Right.
That's quite a jump. How was that for you?
Very exciting, of course.
I can imagine.
Very exciting, of course. And being a new instructor, you learn more about flying than you taught your students, really, because of all the exposure that you had. We taught them full aerobatics and prepared them for combat, actually. So we gave them 200 hours of flying. And then in 1944, when the Air Force became fairly well saturated with pilots, Pan American needed pilots, and they chose 25 pilots out of the training command. So we were transferred from the Air Force to the Navy in one day, and we started hauling then Navy and Marine brass back and forth to Hawaii and down into the South Pacific. So, and then I stayed with Pan Am for a number of years after that.
Well,
so my hobby got in the way of my career.
I wanted to take a moment. You brought a wonderful photo album from that time, and I'd like to take a moment to show our viewers a few pictures, if I may. In fact, why don't I have you show us a little bit of the history?
Okay, this is first page is a group of instructors with one of the first classes of Royal Air Force cadets. And there's the field and the cadets on parade. And some of the airplanes. And this group of guys happened to be my first group of Royal Air Force cadets. They were from Ireland, Scotland, Wales, and London, and
all over Europe.
All over the United Kingdom area, and very, very outstanding young men. Very exciting to be with, except that, you know, you were training them to do bad things, which bothered us all. But that's, and there's groups of other kids. And
that's wonderful.
The airplanes we fly here, getting them into a B-17. And this happens to be a picture of Tony LeVere, chief test pilot for Lockheed at the time. And I had just gone for a ride in the P-38. So that's pretty much.
Wonderful pictures and history.
Good experience, you know.
But I have a question for you. Are you still flying?
I haven't flown since about 3 o'clock this afternoon. I have my own airplane. Use it in my business as well as for pleasure. And it's a great business tool.
Still love it, huh?
Oh, absolutely. Just outstanding. I can't imagine a life without an airplane.
Well, jumping ahead a little bit, how did you go from being a pilot to being a designer of homes?
Well, the first home that I bought in the Bay Area was in San Francisco, South San Francisco, in that wind tunnel there off the end of the airport. And the only day the sun really shone was the day that I bought the house and the day I sold the house. And I decided that I wanted some warm weather. So in traveling around, I discovered Los Altos and made an offer on a lot on the golf course out here, the country club, and decided to design and build my own house, not knowing anything about it at all. You know, it's just one of those crazy ideas. And I found a contractor that was willing to assist me and keep me on the straight and narrow. And about the time I got the house finished, somebody wanted it a whole lot worse than I did. So I sold it to them and started another one. And that led to, and that one sold before it was sheetrock. So that led me into another house. And all I was trying to do, really, quote unquote, is to get myself a house to live in. And after about the fifth house, I was on a trip to Shanghai and came back, and I'd been delayed quite a while because of a typhoon out there. And when I got back, I discovered that the State Contractors Board had discovered my operation. And unfortunately, my superintendent that I had run the work while I was gone said, oh yeah, he owns that lot and that lot there, and he couldn't build a house for that guy over there, you know. And things were bad. So the contractor board representative came out and said, well, why don't you get a contractor's license? I said, well,
why?
I said, I really can't qualify for it. I don't have the work experience. I'm an airline pilot. And he said, well, we like what you're doing. We like your approach to design. We have investigated your business practices, and they seem to be reasonably acceptable. And he says, why don't you go take the test? And I said, well, that shouldn't be too hard. And I took the test, and 10 days later, the license came in the mail. So then I was a contractor. So, and then I kept on building speculative homes, mostly. Once in a while, a contract job. But mostly, my love was the speculative part, because I could design and do them the way I was motivated and had some definite ideas on how I wanted a house to look.
So it was just a series of construction and design jobs that you finally parlayed into a business, a new business.
Yeah.
It's very interesting.
And then it became to the point where it was either fly for a living or build houses for a living. And my seniority group was 23 years and checking out to the left seat as captain. So there really wasn't that big a choice. So I...
The timing was right.
The timing was right, yeah. And business was very, very good in those days. And so it was very satisfying.
Well, tell me a little bit about, you have a unique type of design to the homes that you build. Can you tell me a little bit about that? What's unique?
Well, my philosophy on homes is that I think they should be tied to tradition, but I think they should be contemporized so that they will be good in the foreseeable future or even down the line farther than that. And it has borne out in the fact that these houses that I did 25, 30 years ago are still in demand. And the only one I know that was torn down was one that I lived in for myself, which I did just to get into a house for myself on Sunkiss Lane. And it wasn't much of a house. But the main thought is to try to make not only your initial buyer happy, but to project it so that he is going to enjoy the house and also make money on it when he sells it, without having to tear part of it down and remodel it and so on. This happens to so many homes.
Well, what are some of your signatures? What are, when you think of, when people think of Roscoe homes, what did they think of?
Well, I think one of the first achievements was the creation of the family kitchen.
I understand you were the first to have that in a home.
As far as I know, yes. We did one on Sunkissed Lane that sold for the mighty sum of $30,000. And it had the tile floors and the fireplace and the beam ceilings and the built-in stove and dishwasher. And we had to assemble components to do it because no one at that time was making a built-in unit. It hadn't been conceived yet.
That's amazing, because we take it for granted now.
Yeah. But 1949 was about, I think that was, 48 was the first one that I did that way. And I know of no one else that had done one prior to that.
Interesting. What other signatures, what other firsts were you involved with?
Oh, at Pink Horse, I put in the first house in Pink Horse, I put in the first microwave oven, and no one really knew what they were. And on Saturday and Sundays, I always held open house, and I always had a roaster, a turkey or something like that in there, and let people sample the thing. And the house sold almost immediately. We had three buyers in the house at the same time. I was going from one buyer to the next in other parts of the houses in order to see which one was going to come up with the best deal for me, or I for them, as the case may be.
Sound like a good businessman
yeah,
to me.
And that house also had the first vacuum cleaner, central vacuum system by Sequoia, that was put in the Bay Area. And
so innovation would be?
Innovation, yes. It was what I tried to achieve with so many things, like the built-in barbecue in the house that could be converted to a fireplace as well as a barbecue. And some of those first ones are still being used.
Well, I wanted to talk a little bit about Pink Horse Ranch. From our records, I know that it is part of the old Spanish land parcel, San Antonio Ranch,
right,
from what I understand. It's located about a mile away from here, runs along Adobe Creek and Moody Road, and I understand it has a very colorful history. It was a ranch and then a dairy farm and then a resort for a time.
Yes.
And of all places, you've traveled all over the world in your careers, and why did you choose Los Altos to settle in?
Well, I think it's the best of all worlds. It's within easy distance of the ocean. It's within easy distance of skiing in the mountains or camping or fishing or whatever you want. It's been rural and yet it's sophisticated. As we see right now, climate-wise, there isn't anything like it in the world. The access to the city, the potential growth of the valley, you could tell, was just there. It's when I first came, first house I built in Los Altos Hills, if you look towards the hills at night, you couldn't see a dozen lights.
Huh.
Membership in the Los Altos Golf and Country Club at that time was offered at $300. Try it today.
Things have changed.
Try it today. So, I know of no other place that has the same offerings that Los Altos had at that time or even today.
Well, let me ask you this. You built one of 20, well, you built your first house there and then 29 others followed.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about that process. And
well, I had an idea to establish a upper scale development. And the pattern of the community and the Bay Area, as far as that goes, with developers is to subdivide a piece of property, put in one or two nice homes, and then just sell off the lots. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted an ongoing thing over a period of years that I could establish a community that had some elegance and some character, and I hoped potential value over my lifespan, and I hoped to leave some inheritance to my kids. And so that meant that a good percentage of the homes were then rather high-priced. As a matter of fact, I had the reputation of being the highest-priced builder in the Bay Area at the time. The third house that sold there sold for $110,000, which at that time was the highest speculation house sold in Northern California, according to Western Title Company.
Wow, that's amazing.
And it loaned, a construction loan, a maximum of $30,000. So that shows you what a crazy guy I was. But it was a unique house, and talking about individuality, that building had been the headquarters of the resort. It had a little restaurant in it. It had the swimming pool. And when I joined Rotary Club in 1951, that's where Rotary met.
Wendell, we've got just a little bit of time left, and I want to ask you one question. I wish the show were an hour long. We have a lot to
cover.
Good
thing it isn't.
But what is it about building homes that you love so much? It's been such a major part of your life. What does it hold for you?
Well, I think it's the psychology of it, as much as anything. It's the satisfaction of pleasing people, letting people share their ideas with me, and then try to make them aesthetically correct and economically sound and feasible. And the one-to-one relationship with people, where you act as marriage counselor and advisor, financial advisor, and everything else, you know, you do their decorating for them, I buy their furniture for them, and you direct and control their lives to a large degree, and yet do it, if you do it properly, do it subtly enough so that it is their life and not yours that shows. And when people get together, that I have had happen several times at a party, and somebody says, well, the best house Wendell ever did was mine. And somebody else says, no, the best one he did was mine. And then they ask me which house is my favorite. And I said, well, that's like a mother being asked which one of her children's her favorite. She knows, but she is not going to tell.
Wendell, thank you very much for being with us this evening. I hope to have you back again sometime in the future.
Okay.
We had an opportunity to visit Wendell at Pink Horse Ranch recently. We thought the viewers would appreciate being able to view some of Wendell Roscoe's original designs. We'd like to share that visit with you now. Let's roll that tape.
The beautiful footbridge over Adobe Creek. And I also noticed, as I drove into Pink Horse Ranch, a bridge out in front of the ranch. Can you tell me a little bit about the big bridge out in front?
Well, that's the interesting story, too, in that when I bought the property, it was just about this time of year. Matter of fact, almost exactly. And 3 weeks later, I came out one morning, and it was under a little over 2 feet of water, the whole 42 acres. And being young and very naive and having borrowed all the money I could scrounge and all my own, I was very frightened about the whole thing. And then I realized that this is probably the best thing that could have happened to me, in that there had to be a way to take care of all this water, and it, you know, it is a creek basin and so on. So I decided that I was going to move the creek, and the creek in back of us is the old channel. And the bridge that you came over, an entering Pink Horse, I got a big old grade all in there and dug it out. And the county said, you can't do that. And I said, well, it's done. And so then that was the entrance to the development. So I designed a bridge to put over it. And they said, you can't do that. And I said, well, it's going to be done. They said, well, we won't accept it. And I said, okay, I'll make a toll bridge out of it. And, you know, today, why they would probably put me behind bars forever. But I got away with it, and it was finally accepted. But then after another year went by, in May, we had another one of the big rains, almost like the Christmas rain in 57 or 56. There wasn't a drop of water went out on the main part of the property because the ditch that I dug and all took care of it greatly. Then they tried to assume the responsibility for having it done. And we had to notify the newspapers that that really wasn't the case. That we did it in violation of all their good wishes. So,
good for you, Wendell.
Somewhat of a maverick.
Wendell, I know that not only do you take the environment into consideration as well as the family spirit when you're building a home and designing one, but I also hear that with some of the homes in the area, particularly one, you used a historical monument and integrated that into the design of the home. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
This was originally an 189-acre ranch, and it became the home of the Toyon Dairy, and the silos and an adjoining building, two barns actually facing each other, along with a pasteurizing plant, were part of the dairy setup. And the original intent was to use one of these barns and remodel it along with the silo into a home. But over the years, it deteriorated so rapidly because, I let one neighbor put a couple of horses in there, and then the kids forgot to take care of the horses, and the horses chewed up the barn to the point where it was not structurally sound anymore. And artists used to come out all the time and paint this barn and this silo. And when it became necessary to tear it down, the neighbors were very, very upset. The artist neighbors. But I did insist on retaining the silos because they were in excellent shape. So I decided to make them as dressing rooms for the pool. I was hoping that I would get a client that would want it so that in the upper part I could make a library in the two silos in the what would be the second or third floor, which would be a neat deal, but that hasn't materialized, although the present owner says that one day he'd like to do that. So that's kind of fun.
You know, what is it that you found most fulfilling about your work?
Well, I think you'll remember that we referred to a Christmas party and the reaction of former clients on that. But the satisfaction and the joy of designing and building is just the realization that you have contributed to people's lives, and you hope that it is all in a happy fashion.